So it is a great pleasure for the Department of the Classics in its centenary year to be part of the distinguished Millecom Lecture Series. And it is a particular honor for us to welcome a non-classicist who showed, better than any classicist could, that Homer sang the truth. The truth about war, the truth about the moral dimension of combat trauma, the truth about the veteran's lost capacity to trust. Dr. Jonathan Shay is a graduate of the University of Pennsylvania, where he became an MD and earned a PhD in neuropathology. He is currently a psychiatrist in the Department of Veterans Affairs Outpatient Clinic in Boston. It is there that, since 1987, he has worked with Vietnam veterans suffering from severe psychological injury sustained in combat, a condition generally known as post-traumatic stress disorder, which Dr. Shay thinks, will argue is a misnomer, and I agree with you. Dr. Shay's books are informed by years of patient and, I would say, loving work with veterans. The first book, Achilles in Vietnam, Combat Trauma and the Undoing of Character, published in 1995, is an inquiry into Homer's Iliad as a metaphor for the deforming effects of war on character. To the psychiatrist, Achilles' killing rage results from the convergence of two deeply altering experiences: his commander Agamemnon's betrayal of what is right, which causes the dissolution of the hero's social and moral horizon, and also his immense grief and guilt at the death of his special comrade Patroclus. In his second book, Odysseus in America, Combat Trauma and the Trials of Homecoming, published in 2002, Dr. Shay looks at Homer's poem as our earliest account of a combat veteran trying to make the long journey home after the war. And the epic is also an account of what that combat veteran does once he gets home. Odysseus's post-war adventures at sea and at home reflect the symptoms of what is now called PTSD, the persistent use in civilian life of adaptations necessary to survive in battle, and also a greatly impaired capacity for social trust. The disguise, concealment, lies, and aloofness emblematic of the epic character are in large degree manifestations of the psychological and moral injury suffered at Troy. This second book culminates in a plea for change in the way the United States military organizes itself to fight wars. Desperately lacking are, among other things, cohesion among combat units, competent and ethical leadership, and proper training. Odysseus in America went to press in 2002, before the war in Iraq began in March 2003. Once again, we are faced with a paradox at the core of Dr. Shay's work and mission, that fighting for one's country can easily shatter one's ability to be a good citizen. Now, an event like this one is, before anything else, a joint enterprise. 17 units and programs have lent support to it. And as you know from this wonderful poster, the list is long indeed. And to acknowledge everyone verbally would make a very lengthy introduction lengthier yet. But I would like to thank three colleagues, Gregory Miller, Mark Leff, and Matty Bunsell, respectively from the departments of psychology, history, and anthropology, for supporting the project in its earlier stage. Now, please join me in welcoming Dr. Jonathan Shay, who will accompany us from Troy to Baghdad and ponder with us the question, can the US military learn from Homer's epics?
Thank you, Professor Parka, and thank you to the MillerCom series. Wow, what a turnout. I'm astonished. I will tell you the incredible privilege it's been for me to have these two books. They have opened the doors for me in so many places, and particularly within the U.S. military. Before Achilles in Vietnam was published, I could not get a soul to in uniform to look at it. The door was firmly shut. And then after it was published and received one critical review in the Quarterly Journal of the Army War College called Parameters, suddenly the door began to open. And as people in uniform began to read it, I discovered that especially the Iliad, probably not quite so much the Odyssey, but particularly the Iliad, has profound, profound cultural prestige among military professionals. And that was my foot in the door. They couldn't slam it again. And since that time, it's really been roughly 10 to 12 years, I have been engaged in this incredibly satisfying and stimulating and sometimes somewhat turbulent quest for complete renovation of some of the policies, practices, and culture of our military services with regard to things that would protect the mind and the spirit of the people that we send to do these terrible things and to witness these terrible things and to suffer the terrible things in the overwhelming hideousness of war. And so what I will try to do is to explain and to illustrate the wonderful two-way traffic that it's been my privilege to bring to people's attention, that we can still learn new things about today's soldiers and veterans from these great epics. And it is two ways, because we can learn new things about the epics from today's actual soldiers and veterans. I'm going to emphasize the military dimension here, in part because of the nature of this event. But the classicists have been incredibly generous in their welcome to these efforts that I've had the incredible dumb luck to embark on. They have not treated me as go away, you're an amateur. I am an amateur. But they haven't shooed me away, and they've treated me with enormous generosity and welcome for these efforts. But my main focus will be on the military side of it rather than there will be plenty of Homeric stuff, but the focus is today and today's institutions. The rap that I give to people in uniform today is that I am a missionary for the veterans I serve. I'm talking to you on their behalf because they don't want other young kids wrecked the way they were wrecked. And they care deeply about it. And even though it means sacrifices for them because they like having me around in the clinic, they like me, and they like the work I do with them, but they are willing to see my time with them limited as long as they know that I'm out there trying to make things better for the young kids that are out there now. Veterans are a very diverse group. Their politics are very diverse. Their social views are very diverse. Their styles and forms of life are very diverse, ranging from life in a homeless shelter to CEO of Fortune 100 corporations. But the one thing that they are absolutely united on is that they want to protect and take care of the young kids that are going into harm's way today. So, having stuck the audience with a pin, and okay, I admit it, I have a perverse streak. I like seeing an audience of senior officers sort of startle as though they've been stuck with a pin. When I say that I'm a missionary from the veterans I serve, this is a very successful rhetorical move on my part, believe me. I tell them that the veterans have taught me that there are three things that protect the mind and the spirit of a fighting man, or today woman, in a fight. There are three things that protect. And those three things are positive qualities of community in the face-to-face unit. And their term for this is cohesion. But having engaged in the mother and apple pie praise of cohesion, I nail them on the fact that cohesion cannot be built unless there is stability. And the history of American military forces is that the units get shuffled like decks of cards, and that I tell them the first and most important preventive psychiatry thing you have to do is to keep people together. Train them together, send them into danger together, and bring them home together. This isn't rocket science, but this is really heavy lifting for our forces to actually make the institutional changes that will permit that to happen. So that's one. The second is expert, ethical, and properly supported leadership. Now, this again has the sort of apple pie quality, but it is fortunate that I have had many active duty people supporting my work and feeding me with education and facts so that they cannot get away with preening and primping and saying, oh, well, we're absolutely the best in the world, because they know that I know that they are not doing a very good job in this area, that in critical, particularly critical, tactical and operational expertise, our line leaders are often quite deficient and systemically mediocre. And with the truly gifted and accomplished not getting recognized and promoted. So the second is leadership. The third is prolonged, cumulative, and highly realistic training for what people actually have to do and face. So my mantra is cohesion, leadership, training. Now, this is a very easy sell in the sense that they say, oh, well, we know about these things. We want these. These are combat strength multipliers, and they are combat strength multipliers. So I give them the auto mechanic shrug and say, okay, you want them, but and I want them, and we all agree they're good and important. Why are we doing such a lousy job of actually achieving them within our forces? And there's sort of shifting from buttock to buttock and looking at shoes, and the answer comes, it's the personnel system. Well, there is an element of legitimacy in that, and to some degree my quest has morphed into a quest to completely renovate the military personnel system so that cohesion, leadership, and training are maximized. But that gets into really into the weeds, and I want to come back to the Homeric side of all this. Cohesion, leadership, and training. You talk to officers who have progressed a fair distance, who've served a long time, and they are inclined to say, well, it really all boils down to leadership. And it's true that over time, they're absolutely right, because policy, practice, and culture are in the hands of military leaders to a degree that is really unique among institutions. That if you look, for instance, at the transformation of American forces with regard to race, it is astonishing, because these institutions have become as close to being race blind as anything in the whole country. On a daily basis, it is routine to see non-whites supervising and bossing whites in the workplace, in the military workplace, and nobody even noticing it. Not that they're sort of restraining their resentment. It's just simply normal. And that's an astonishing thing. So once a military institution decides that it's going to change its own culture, there are many, many more opportunities and means to do it than in a typical civilian institution. So, but that's over time. But in the moment, the leader can only work with the cohesion that's there at that moment and with the training that's there at that moment. And so those three dimensions of cohesion, leadership, training, and training are always there in an actual real-life military situation. Now, what do we learn from the Iliad and to a lesser degree the Odyssey about military leadership? I have given a variation on this talk to many active duty audiences, including, and the handout you have is one of the handouts that I used at the Secretary of the Navy's guest lecture in the Naval Command Center in the Pentagon in the year 2000, that was really a trip. Because you have to imagine something that could have been sort of an enormous walk-in freezer set up like an auditorium. The walls were very thick. It's a secure conference room where they can do top secret briefings. And so you get in through a thick door that looks like the door of a walk-in freezer, and the room was literally full of Marine general officers, Navy flag officers, and various assistant secretaries of the Navy and Secretary Danzig. And I spoke with them, and the title was Homer on Military Leadership. And the truth of the matter is that they didn't come to hear Shay. They came to hear about Homer. And the Secretary of the Navy may have a variety of powers and influence and authority, but if they didn't really want to come, trust me, the Secretary of the Navy can't make a Marine 3-star come and sit and listen to a lecture on Homer if he doesn't want to come. So they weren't there under orders, and they weren't coming to hear me. They were here coming to hear about Homer. And that is in itself something somewhat remarkable. I mean, we have to sort of take that in. Now, there are numerous military leaders represented in the epics, but the three main ones are Achilles, Agamemnon, and Odysseus. And I'm not going to walk through the rubric that you have in your handout. I think you will recognize both the Homeric portraits in this rubric, as well as recognize actual leaders in both civilian and military settings that are sketched there by Homer. I think if I'm going to concentrate on anything, I'm going to emphasize the remarkable portrait that Homer gives of Achilles, because if you read the Iliad quickly, especially if you only have read it because you were forced to in high school, that what you come away with is the idea, okay, this is an adolescent jerk who makes a big mess, and that's the end of the story. But the Homerists, because their stock and trade is careful and persistent and patient reading of the text, recognized really not a long, long time ago, because, well, let me back up a bit, that in the 20th century, especially since World War I, there is a kind of consensus that has developed among Homerists that Achilles is really a tragic figure, that he had good character prior to the opening events of Iliad 1, when he butts heads with Agamemnon. And the reason that that is able to take hold is because they read carefully, and the Iliad has salted throughout its whole length details about Achilles' character prior to these events, where the Iliad opens with a thunderclap. And what we learn is that in addition to his great physical courage and stamina, that is that Achilles has moral courage, which Odysseus is totally lacking in. He has a very broad pro-social concern for all of the troops, not just for his battalion, the Myrmidons. He cares about everyone. We learn just by accident, that he's a big-time military surgeon, that he is specialized in the care of wounds and has all kinds of tricks up his sleeve that nobody else has, that he's reputed to have learned from the wise centaur Chiron. He is the classic light infantryman in personality. What you see is what you get. He is blunt. He is unsparingly truthful. And I can't address this from my own knowledge of Homeric Greek, which is virtually nil. But I'm told by scholars that when he's upset, and we see him plenty upset in the Iliad, but when he's upset that his language gets a bit coarse and sometimes ungrammatical. Now, that's... Odysseus never loses his golden tongue. He is passionate and energetic, and he does show his emotions and does not conceal them, as Odysseus is so brilliant at doing. He has a giant thumos, this wonderful Homeric word, which I have tried to encourage back into circulation and current psychological and philosophic usage, and I'm not alone in that. Frank Fukuyama has tried also to get it back into circulation. And I encourage people to understand that thumos is the spirit of, is the energy of spirited honor. It is one's ideals, ambitions, and attachments, plus the energy that infuses these. So thumos, Achilles has a giant thumos. He is a large spirited, large, he's a large person in every sense. And that is Homer's portrait, which you would never guess from the stereotype of, you mention Achilles, and if you take out of the 100 people who know who he is, apart from, oh, didn't he get an arrow in his heel or something like that? If you actually, most of them say, oh, sulking in his tent, and that's the sum total of what they think they know about Achilles. What a contrast. And that's part of the amazing art of Homer, to not open with a long narrative portrait of what it was like growing up with a mother who was a goddess and so on and so on. So you drop right into the middle of the action in Iliad 1. Now, it's clear to you, I'm not good at concealing it or pretending, that this Achilles character is very much to my liking. I have met a number of military leaders who are Achilles characters to the T, and surprisingly, sometimes they rise rather high. Jack Keane, the acting chief of staff of the Army, before the current chief of staff, was such a person. And I just immediately gravitated to this person because of that quality of what you see is what you get, and his directness, very Achilles-like. Now, I want to see if I can reconnect with these Homeric things with what I was telling you about my missionary pitch. And unfortunately, it'll take me a minute to find where I am in my thoughts. Every military officer in the U.S. forces is in a whole ecology of power and authority. There is really nobody who just is a boss and who doesn't have a boss himself. So the issue of how one comports oneself toward one's own seniors is a critical issue of character for American officers. And what is astonishing is Homer's portrait of Odysseus here. Odysseus, if you'll forgive the rather crude language, is a absolutely classic ass-kisser. In the Iliad, you only once hear Odysseus tell his boss Agamemnon that that's a really bad idea. Only once. And I want to walk you through a disastrous episode where Odysseus did pull Agamemnon's chestnuts out of the fire, but not by exercising moral courage, but by simply by cleaning up after him. And that is the remarkable scene in Iliad 2 when Agamemnon says to his officers that he's going to pretend to give up the war. It's the day after he has publicly dishonored Achilles by seizing his geras, his prize of honor. And he does one of the nuttiest things in the annals of military leadership, whether real or fictional. He says to his officers, "We better get a move on it if we're going to get the men ready. But I'm going to test them first with a little speech. You know, the usual drill. Order them to beat a retreat to their ships. It's up to each one of you to persuade them to stay." Now, apparently, he's pulled this dumb trick enough times before that it seems normal. And nobody says to him, "That's a really bad idea." Certainly, Odysseus, who functions as his chief of staff throughout the Iliad, doesn't say, "Boss, you sure you want to do that?" And then, with the whole army mustered, Agamemnon stands up before them and says that even though they came ashore at Troy 10 years earlier with a 10-to-1 advantage over the Trojans, that Zeus has decreed that they will fail. There's so much sacrifice and so much suffering under the bridge. And he says, "Now this is what I say, and I want us all to obey. Let's clear out with our ships and head for home. There is no more hope that we will take Troy's town." There is a stampede to the ships. And that mad rush takes everyone by surprise. Apparently, in the past, when Agamemnon has pulled this stunt, the troops had stood fast and say, "Hey, we're here for the duration." And Agamemnon is surprised by the stampede. The Greek officers are surprised. Even the gods are surprised when the army bolts for the ships. But should we be surprised? And the answer is no. And the reason that we should not be surprised is that this is the absolutely predictable result of betraying the moral order of one's forces. Homer is amazing here, where he lets us hear the mutterings of the troops. Not specifically at this moment, but for instance, earlier in Iliad 1, when Agamemnon behaves so atrociously toward the priest of Apollo, whose daughter is Agamemnon's war trophy. And the priest of Apollo comes with very lavish ransom, saying, please give me back my daughter, and here is ransom for you. And we hear the troops muttering, and the troops say, respect the priest, accept the ransom, respect the priest, accept the ransom. And so we know, this isn't Shay's conjecture, this isn't an anachronism of Shay putting 21st century values on this 8th century BC poem. It's right there in the text that Agamemnon has a tin ear about the moral consensus of his forces. And what happens when he betrays what's right with his forces? They desert. They stampede to the ship. That's the consequence. Now, he's done several other things that betray their moral consensus between the priest of Apollo and this stampede in Book Two. But that's the basic thing. In the modern world, people have less scope to say, I quit, I'm going home, than in the ancient world. But they still have the capacity to desert psychologically and to say, I'm just going to do the minimum I can do to get by and to not draw attention to myself. And once I can leave the service, I'm out of here. Now, what do we bring home about this? I submit that some of our senior civilian leaders, who I will leave nameless, but I think you will know who I'm referring to, seem to have a similar tin ear about the moral consensus of the current American troops. They seem to think it would be cool to just kill adversaries in Iraq if there was an opportunity to take them captive. I mean, to say, oh, well, we'll catch bin Laden or we'll kill him with that. You recognize that little shrug going with the words, or we'll kill him. Like, it's negligible. I mean, this is an ethical communication that has a powerful impact. And it is contrary to the moral consensus of our people in uniform, both the officers and the enlisted men. If you don't believe that, read, there are two books that describe the same fight in Iraq. One by an embedded reporter, Evan Wright, whose regular job is with Rolling Stone. And the other is by the Marine platoon commander in whose platoon Evan Wright was embedded. The Marine officer's book, he's now out of the Marine Corps, he has gone back to school. The Marine officer's book is called One Bullet Away, and his name is Nathaniel Fick, F-I-C-K. And the Evan Wright's book has an awful title that I think was cooked up by the marketing department of the publisher, called Generation Kill. And it is an excellent book, and the title is awful. but it's a first-rate book and worth reading, and you hear the same fight through these two very different eyes. But the thing they agree on is that the junior enlisted Marines care deeply about the bright line between murder and militarily legitimate and militarily necessary killing. And they care very deeply about that. And it is a deep offense to them for civilians in any role and any rank to snicker at or just shrug at the ethical constraints that our service members are asked to abide by in these fights we send them into. I realize that I've been babbling for quite a long time, and I really want to give people a chance to comment and throw eggs and ask questions. So I just want to wrap up by pointing out that when I speak of prevention of psychological and moral injury in military service, and that's always the way I put it, preventing psychological and moral injury, the Homeric episodes of betrayal of what's right by someone with institutional power, that the consequences for those everywhere within view of this are just terrible. There are no private wrongs in military, the use of power within military organizations. A violation of the moral consensus injures everyone. Agamemnon would certainly say, butt out, this is private between me and Achilles, but it just doesn't work that way. And the result is desertion, passive obstructionism, gold bricking, petty theft, outright desertion, sabotage, fragging, and even treason. So in a war, the consequences are catastrophic. So I'm going to stop there and listen to what you folks have to say.
Could I ask you all to somehow indicate if you're going to ask a question? We can get a microphone to you and then just keep passing it. This room is so packed that otherwise we may not be able to hear each other. Anybody within my sight here?
And I can share my... Here.
You'll need the microphone for my voice. I don't know.
Yes, we
do. Do you need the microphone?
If this is being recorded, I don't know if the microphone is necessary or if it's not being recorded, you can certainly hear your voice.
Okay. My name is Joy Thornton. I'm a university community member. And I wondered whether you don't feel that Homer himself wants us, the readers, to admire Odysseus enormously, not necessarily as a leader of troops, but as a terribly clever human being who succeeds at everything he tries to do.
Odysseus is an amazing figure because he is very capable in certain limited roles and is an utter catastrophe in others. And a typical military personnel person will say, our job is to get the right person in the right job. And putting him in any kind of a troop leadership job is a catastrophe. He destroys his troops. His laos, his people, his troops are destroyed. And in Odysseus in America, I have a bill of particulars, an indictment. I've drawn up an indictment against Captain Odysseus, the charges he would have to answer to in a modern court of inquiry or court martial for just number one, what happened to the 12 ships that you were commanding? Where are they? And you had 600, we would call them marine infantry because they both were rowers and fighters. But he was an unmitigated disaster as a troop leader, but as an intelligence officer, as a strategic deception planner, as a staff officer, he was not bad, but not the very best because he didn't stand up to his boss when his boss was really off base and embarking on a disastrous course. So, as to how much Homer wants us to admire him, it's the artist is simply doing what he's doing. It's worth remembering that the stock of Odysseus has risen and fallen and risen and fallen over the millennia. The poets of the Athenian tragic theater, for the most part, detested him. He was a stage villain for most of Athenian plays that we have. And it's only later that we have the idealization of Odysseus as some sort of proto-scientist who goes into the Cyclops cave and leads six men to their deaths by doing so. Because he's so curious. He wants to know. Well, that's not a responsible leader. There's this.
You mentioned it in one of your three items for protecting the mind of a soldier, prolonging cumulative training. What do you think the military is lacking in that? Now, I bring the example of the Marine Corps, they have extensive basic training and combat training. What more would they need? I'm curious.
It's in the nature of our nervous systems that we tend to treat what is over a long period of time as normal and right, and forget that we do know how to do things a lot better. The ordinary Marine infantry battalion does not have a full year to train, which is almost certainly the minimum required for truly expert unit skills. I just want to tell you a little dialogue I had with a superb Marine a lieutenant colonel who has become a good friend over the years. And I was commenting on a training site that he had created for his battalion on the web and went into details of night fighting practices. And I said to him, this, from what I know about night fighting, this is a really good training site and really good material, but it makes me uneasy that this is on the public web. Anybody can go look. There are people who would like to know how we're fighting at night so they can figure out how to defeat it. And he said, oh, don't worry about it. We're not that good. We're not training on any of that stuff. So the fact is that relative to most Army infantry, Marine infantry is better trained, but that's not good enough. The true unit skills, which are what really allows an infantry unit to win its fights with minimum casualties on its own side and minimum casualties on the enemy's side as well, is we are not up to the level that we know we could be if we did what we needed to do. There's one in the back. Oh, maybe the microphone could stay up here and then go back. Okay, too late.
I was wondering if you could comment on the current situation in Iraq as it relates to the discussion you presented. And our military is telling us that they are in a process of training an army and a security force for Iraq. And you talked about cohesion, leadership, and training. And in terms of having an effective security force and an effective army, my question to you is it realistic to expect in the situation in Iraq that our government is telling us we can train and equip their country to provide the security they need when you were telling us our Marines need at least a year of cohesive training? In other words, the characteristics you tell us to make an effective security force, I'm asking you, why is our military telling us they can do that in a chaotic situation like Iraq? Is that even realistic or possible? That's my question.
I want to say that, first of all, what I was saying in response to this gentleman was talking about flat-out combat infantry. And to my knowledge, the American forces are attempting to train, as you correctly put it, security forces, a gendarmerie, in effect, the carabinieri. And I'm not saying that this calls for a low level of skill, but there are different skills, and it's conceivable. Conventional wisdom, at least, says that you can train up on the skills for constabulary work more quickly than you can train up on the skills that would allow you to, for instance, penetrate a defended position in an infantry fight. I'm not a universal expert, and the ultimate answer to your question is, I don't know. It appears to me that the problems with what we say we're doing in Iraq are less in the realm of the technical tasks and the training tasks of training troops than in the realm of the where people's hearts are and to how successful we are likely to be in training a force that enjoys legitimacy among the various people that they are trying to police. Without legitimacy, it's a hopeless, hopeless task. So in the terms that you said in your question, my sense is that, number one, I don't know. I'm not a universal expert, and I don't know how plausible this claim is. But it also seems to me that the problems are not in the area of training expertise or training flow diagrams, but in other areas where we may be in really bad trouble.
I'm a little disturbed by your comments right now. Is it fair to blame an American military, which is rather small, which is on a rotation system that doesn't allow much time for training because of essentially ill-considered interventionist policies on the part of the United States government? It is not, you know, the Army has to do what it's told to do. If it says, you know, they say train Iraqi security forces, they're going to do that job because that's what they got to do. To what extent do you feel it's fair to focus your criticisms on the administration writ large, and to what extent are they specifically related to the kinds of things the military itself can control?
The current situation is a sort of a train wreck of national command decisions, which did not seem to take into account intelligent and thoughtful recommendations by the military professionals, number one. And number two, the deficiencies in the American military institutions are deficiencies that were there long before this current situation. And a group that I chair in Washington once a month, known by, be prepared to really have your heart race when you hear the name of this group, First Friday Defense Lunch. Isn't that inspiring? Come on. But over the course of the last roughly 8 years, we have had all of the living leadership of the U.S. Army during the great period of self-reform from the mid-70s to the mid-80s. Shai Meyer, Bob Elton, Dick Treffry, Don Starry. Unfortunately, Max Thurman is dead, and that's a great loss. But we, and every one of them, without, to our knowledge, consulting each other, said the changes that they tried to do and which were rapidly undone are changes that require 10 years to get them settled and in the institution. And this is maddeningly hard to do in American military institutions because, as any student of culture change in large organizations will tell you, what is absolutely essential is continuity of leadership. You can tell me the correct number, but the number of years that the elder Moltke was the chief of staff of the Prussian army. What was it, 30 years? And that was, in a certain sense, what it took to transform the Prussian army into what it became in the mid-19th century. So there are structural and cultural obstacles to the kinds of changes that are needed, and which very little that I say in the area of changes is, none of it is new with me. It's almost all repeating what serious and sober and responsible American military leaders have said in the past we need to do. And typically they say it after a fight, and they say, oh boy, we must never do it that way again. And here are the changes we need. And then cohesion, leadership, and training is my summary of what they say after every fight. So I'm not trying to lay the blame for national command decisions on the forces. And yes, they are obliged to carry those out. I do have to say that I ask myself repeatedly, what has happened to resignation under protest? Rick Shinseki, the Army Chief of Staff, a fine soldier, very honorable, very devoted to his troops, a good soldier. I cannot fathom why he did not resign under protest after Rumsfeld repeatedly rejected his advice. Mr. Secretary, it's clear I no longer enjoy your confidence. Here are my stars. And that would have been a totally honorable thing for him to do and a constructive thing for him to do. I have never had the opportunity to ask him. I have friends who say they'd introduce me to him, but it seems unlikely that I'd get to the point of confidence with him that I'd feel comfortable asking him that question, why didn't you resign? But I'd sure like to know the answer.
I would propose, and like some feedback, the tragedy that is Vietnam, for most of us, we served over there, it's over 35 years ago now, and you still treat that to this day. And again, because we could never rationalize our actions to what we knew and the rationalization of why we were there again. As we know, Gulf of Tonkin never occurred today. The mirror and the image that's appearing out of Gulf War I with the same thing, where the rationalization justification for war has hit the left half, the right half of the brain of that warrior. And now with Gulf War II, we're seeing the suicides, the spousal abuse, the abuse of EPWs and everybody else in civilian population. What does it portend for the future? Where are we going and what's going to happen? And what will be the outcome?
Well, I want to say that as much and as deeply as I am devoted to our having wise and effective national command decisions on where we fight, why we fight, what the objectives are of a fight, I do not place that in the center of my thinking about protecting the troops. What I place in the center of my thinking about the protecting the troops is policies, practices, and culture of the institutions as they do their daily business with each other, both in garrison and in during operations. And so, just to take as an example the horrible, you were alluding to the horrible murder-suicides at Fort Bragg. Every one of those was a career NCO or an officer. And we have a culture and a set of policies that says that if you are even known to set foot in mental health, your career is over. And these are people, all of them special operations troops who had been deployed repeatedly into very hairy and awful situations, and every one of them, and God knows where in the world doing what, but every single one of them into situations that could have injured them very seriously, psychologically speaking. But because of that institutional setting, not to speak of the macho culture of the special operations people, which says that it would be an admission of weakness and make other people give them the hairy eyeball and wonder whether they can be relied upon. But that's the inevitable tragic outcome of trying to deal with psychological injury by submerging it. It just doesn't work, and it kills people. Most often, the people it kills is the service member himself. Who needs the help? Yeah. Let's go over to this side of the room.
I'm working on a project which is, in a way, a mutatis mutandis, somewhat similar to what you're doing. I'm working with a professor of the surgery of the brain at Harvard Medical, who was old enough to have read the Iliad in Greek years ago at Exeter and then again at Harvard College. And he's doing a study of wounds in the Iliad. And he was just surprised when he was rereading the Iliad as a doctor, and has found that again and again and again, there is an extraordinary precision and accuracy about the wounds. Or when one is hit over the head, what is described is what happens. And if you're stabbed in one place and you survive that, in another place you don't, or how the blood appears and this sort of thing. So he's finding, from the point of view of wounds, an amazing accuracy. Homer wasn't out on cloud nine somewhere writing about war. He really knew that stuff.
I have made the same observation that, and I take my own thoughts on this at a large discount, that it's probably my ego as a physician getting involved. But we hear about the battalion surgeons in the Iliad. Macon is one of the doctors. And my imagination is that Homer was a military surgeon, that he took care of wounds, but he was also, like Achilles and like Macon, a fighting man. Yeah. And because the wounds are extremely accurately described, I think I went through the Iliad and identified only one that was grossly non-anatomical. But mostly they are anatomically precise and would be relatively inaccessible to a lay person because, for instance, it's not intuitively obvious to a lay person that a spear entering through the buttocks would exit through the bladder, for example. I mean, when you think about it, you say, oh yeah, that's true. But, I mean, Homer just tosses that off because, in my view, he's seen it. He's been there. He's done it. Let's...
Hi, I'm Carol Symes. I teach history here, and my sister works in military intelligence, which is interesting, and she used to work at Fort Bragg. I wonder if you could tell me what your... from your reading of the Iliad in particular, how military intelligence is gathered and received by the troops. In other words, what seems to be, from Homer's perspective, sort of the cumulative wisdom about that? And sort of very personal, because my sister is always frustrated in not finding information that she gathers is not actually going anywhere, as you can imagine. It seems to me that obviously with Odysseus we have one example of a reconnaissance man. But there are other examples too, and of course even reading entrails could count as military intelligence in Homer. And I just wonder whether you had any insights or feelings about that from your reading.
My comments on that are based on exactly the same scene that you have in mind. In the Iliad, and I have a terrible memory for numbers, I can't tell you book which. I guess it's book 8?
I would guess.
The Night Reconnaissance, where Odysseus and Diomedes go out to do a snoop on the Trojans, who are now feeling full of piss and vinegar and are camped in the field instead of retiring behind the walls of Troy as they've been doing for 10 years. And there's a byplay that's fascinating with a Trojan spy who is intending to do the same thing. And they capture and extract from this Trojan spy, and someone will help me with a name I've forgotten.
I don't remember.
Anyway, maybe it will come back to me. But again? Dolon, yes. They capture and extract from Dolon that the whole Trojan senior leadership is meeting unguarded by the tomb of Ilos, which is clearly within reach of Odysseus and Diomedes. We already know that Odysseus is capable of very accurate rapid aimed fire with his bow, and we know that he's carrying his bow. Homer has supplied us with that detail. It was an incredible opportunity to decapitate the Trojan leadership. And what do? They go herring off after the prize chariot team and fancy chariot of, I think it's a Lydian or Lycian contingent. My memory again is failing me. And they kill the Lydian king, they drive the chariot off and outrun the hue and cry. And they come into the, they drive this team into the Greek camp that at this point is, has this improvised rampart guarding it. They drive through the gates, and there's big hooray, they're back safely, and look at that fabulous team and that fabulous chariot. And nobody debriefs them. The intelligence that they do gather is never either inquired after or used, and they also make no effort to communicate it, and it appears that the real outcome of this very dangerous night reconnaissance is a stiff drink and a hot bath. That's Homer on battlefield intelligence and reconnaissance.
Two more questions for that.
Okay. Right behind you and then you.
I was just wondering about the issue of, just yesterday I think it was, the Pentagon acknowledged that white sulfur, which they had said for white phosphorus, which they said hadn't been used, had been dropped on during the siege of Fallujah. I'm wondering about that from a therapeutic angle. If part of therapy is to acknowledge and to bring things out, what are the chances of recovery when you have an entire government that's set on keeping secrets? And
when the senior leadership lies about what the troops know to be true, it is profoundly disturbing to them. They're willing for tactically and operationally sensitive information to be withheld from the enemy, but the enemy certainly knows that white phosphorus, or in the military slang, Willy Peter, has been dropped on them. It's no secret from them who exactly, what is the tactical and operational payoff of maintaining that secrecy? White phosphorus, when used against human targets, is an unbelievably cruel weapon. And it's not clear to me what the military it's in effect a terror weapon. It's not clear under what circumstances against a troop target it would be called for.
I wonder if you can sort of think about this cohesion and stability issue, whether it goes back to fundamentally American culture rather than just the military culture. Because we have a culture which is very moving. There's a lot of geographic mobility. There's a sort of a great value in doing things differently, in changing things, and so on. And maybe this is where we are beginning to have this problem.
I totally agree with both the spirit and the content of your comment. The book on military personnel policy, practice, and culture by Major Don Vandergriff it's going to stand like a monument that anybody who writes or talks about military personnel is going to have to orient toward that landmark. And he traces the American military personnel system right back to concepts of industrial management originating at the beginning of the 20th century and concepts of business management originating in the first third of the 20th century, respectively, enlisted personnel management at the beginning of the 20th century and officer personnel management in the middle. And so what I'm, just to make this point, there is a one-liner that typically in American military circles gets all the heads around the table bobbing like these Buddha dolls that you can buy in San Francisco, that were also called the nodding dog, because they're dog dolls that, you know, the head goes up and down. And this one-liner is that a military organization always reflects the culture that produces it. Now, this is one of those half-truths, and it's a dangerous half-truth, because what the military institutions reflect is some part of the civilian culture, but you can't immediately tell for sure what part. And when this is deployed in a military setting, almost always people go on with saying, and we value individual initiative, and we are stand for freedom and the dignity of the individual, and all this kind of thing. And guess what? The de facto culture coming out of World War II in the American forces is instant blind obedience and a suppression of initiative. So that part of the culture never got into the military. But what did get into the military is certain concepts of management science. The individual soldier is replaceable parts that are fungible. This one's broken, bring me another. Where the social connectedness of soldiers with each other's is an invisible and negligible matter, unimportant, not to be cultivated, not to be measured, not to be considered. So, and then in the officer area, the idea that officership is a form of general management. No particular expertise is required apart from those general skills of management to organize, to plan, to motivate, I forget, there's a list that's sort of a classic list of the functions of the general manager. And this is a disastrous notion. If you're an artillery battalion commander and you don't know how to control the fire of multiple batteries because you lack the technical expertise in your military function, it's going to be a disaster for the infantry or who are depending on you to stay alive during an infantry attack on their position. And that has happened over and over again in American forces. So I believe you are totally correct in that the military has come to embrace aspects of civilian culture which are so badly suited to what they are asked to do. I guess I'm going to stop there.